happens to be young people, because you are going to determine the future of this country. And being an incurable optimist, I've always believed that the future is better than the present. But we have to draw from the past for motivation. And you see, we have many illustrious people in the past. You see, ultimately the freedom did not come by sitting, by people who have not distinguished themselves. If you think of the great leaders who brought us freedom, every one of them was very distinguished in his own way before he entered politics. And I think the intrinsic worth of each one of them really made all the difference. So, you see, Pandit Nehru had said, I'm the first servant of the country. Now that is the spirit in which each one of them works. Think of any name. They were all illustrious people, very distinguished in their respective professions, who chose to give up a luxurious life and enter politics, and that's why we were able to gain freedom. For them, politics was not a means of livelihood. It was actually public service. When I was in the court, a writ petition came up for consideration in which I was very unhappy to find, or very distressed to find, some people, so-called public men, had filed the petition in which the relief claim was that they are not public servants. So when the matter came up for hearing, I told them, I said, you are probably not aware of what. I think that time has come, and the constitution which we have is one of the best that one could have thought of. Let me share with you, when I was in the court and we were dealing with matters involving constitutional issues, I always wondered that something, the meaning of certain provisions which we were struggling to discern, how could these men who had a lot more to do, and for them, making the constitution was only one part of their public life, how could they have that foresight, and how could they contribute to that extent? If you see the Constituent Assembly debates, and I'm sorry to say, compare them with the present ones, you'll see the world of difference. I think that has to be the ideal you have to keep in mind. And therefore, take from the past all that is good. And please remember, why this violence? This violence is something, you see, as someone rightly said, the conflict starts in the mind. The physical act is merely the result of that. And ultimately, why do values have importance? Because values determine your response to a given situation when you have more than one available option. And that's why, you see, it is important to have the proper values and inculcate them as much as you can. Another great Indian, Rajgopalachari, whom we only always called Rajaji, he said something which I'm very fond of quoting, particularly when I go to universities, colleges, etc., and meet young people, because I think that's the crux of the matter. If you combine what Rajaji said with what Gandhiji said, I think that's the complete picture. Gandhiji said, be the change you want to see in the world. Everyone is frustrated with all the wrong things which are happening. But we don't examine where we have failed, where, you see, the change which we want to bring, are we making that change within ourselves? Take the case of the recent incident of 16 December, which has very rightly created such a furore and activated everyone to try to do something. And I also happen to be involved at the government's instance in doing something in that direction. What was more shocking than the apathy, inaction and incompetence of the police force was the apathy of the civil society, as newspaper reports which must be believed, said that more than 50 persons passed that way when those two young people, completely disrobed and badly injured, were lying on the roadside. No one stopped to give any help. In this cold winter, I believe everyone wears more clothes than what he needs. And even the ladies which passed that way, no one thought of, you see, taking off her own shawl and draping at least that young lady who was lying completely distraught. Now, is that not something which we have to think of? And if we think of that, I want to tell you that there is a, in addition to the values of the Indian ethos, the rich heritage of our composite culture, by which we swear time and again, the Constitution itself obliges every citizen, irrespective of whether you hold any public office or not, irrespective of whether you have a public duty to perform or not. In Article 51A, the first, you see, the very first fundamental duty of every citizen, which is the primary status of every one of us, whether if we hold any public office, then the duties of that office are in addition to the duties, fundamental duties of citizens, which is the very first. The first is to abide by the Constitution. Now, if you abide by the Constitution, justice, liberty, equality, fraternity, etc., these are the objectives, assuring the dignity of the individual. Mind you, the word individual is used, which is gender neutral, and equality is as much for the women folk, so that in addition to Article 14, you have Article 15 also, which specifically mentions no discrimination on the ground of race, sex, caste, etc., etc. Now, if that is the constitutional obligation, and as Aristotle had said long back, 23 to 25 BC in Plato, you see, he said, every citizen must be educated in the spirit of the Constitution if the Constitution is to survive. So the Constitution has been framed by those great men. For its survival, it is necessary. I have always been for democratic methods, constitutional methods of protest also. For example, I see that now that the time has come that people are ventilating their grievance and public anger is getting mobilized, you see, against things which should not happen, the aberrations. The means to be adopted to ventilate that anger is not to be undemocratic. And that is where I say, those people, I don't want to name anyone, mobilizing public anger against corruption was all right. But then to say that I will substitute the constitutional or national, the national institution of parliament, you see, provided, created by the Constitution, and make a law which you must put your thumb mark, is not the Constitution. The report which I have given, we have made recommendations, but then the law is to be made by you in the parliament. I mean, these are recommendations if you have better reasons for doing something else, because you are the ones to do it. But in the process, you can't start de novo. You must take into account all the reasons given for every recommendation or those which may come hereafter. And I think that is what has made the difference. But I would have preferred not to talk about it, but I am saying it only to tell you the difference. That, you see, the difference is this, that the earlier agitations for a good cause mobilizing public anger against corruption, so long as it mobilized the public anger and resorted to democratic means for finding the solution, that was welcome. But then saying, you are no good, I'm the one who knows, who's the know-all, I say this, therefore do it, that's not, you are not, you are violating the very first fundamental duty in clause A of Article 51A, which requires you to abide by the Constitution. Now, take the recent incident. Now, it all arises out of a different mindset. We are not prepared to accept, in spite of guaranteeing equality in the Constitution, that women are entitled to as much dignity and as much dignified life as everyone else. The preamble of the Constitution assures dignity of the individual, does not distinguish, that's gender neutral. So what the focus of our report is shifting from the mindset of patriarchy to focusing on the right to life with dignity and bodily integrity of every woman. For which, you see, many people say, you have exceeded your brief, you have talked of things which, you see, are not your remit. Well, I haven't answered that, I think that's for others to answer. But since I'm speaking to you and in this context, and you are the ones, think about it. I'm not saying what I say is absolutely right, you think about it. You are meant to apply your own mind. Another fundamental duty of every citizen is in clause E of Article 51A, and what is that? To renounce practices derogatory to women, to abide by the Constitution and to renounce practices derogatory to the women. Now, if this is the these are the fundamental duties of every citizen, now see everything in perspective. Everything which impacts on or impinges on or can be called as an aberration in our performance of this duty towards women is something which is within the remit. Now, you take the case of, say, sexual assault. The most aggravated form of sexual assault in the form of rape is not the starting point, that's the end point. Unless you deal with the street Romeos who start with stalking, accusing, and all that, they will not graduate to the next level of groping in public transport, etc., etc., or voyeurism, etc., and ultimately postgraduate or obtain a doctorate by becoming rapists. So you have to deal with the entire aspect. When you talk of speedy justice in these cases, you can't confine yourself only to the time taken for the trial. You have to start with, you see, the major grievance, which no one can dispute, is FIRs are not registered, first of all, when a sexual offense is reported. Very often there's pressure in the family, the friends, others. And supposing, overcoming all that, the victim goes to the police station. Well, the kind of treatment she receives, she would regret having gone there. Then, you see, supposing that is done, then the medical examination. The medical examination is so vulgar. That's a continuing sexual offense, if I may say so. So how could we ignore police reforms? How could we ignore medical regime of examination, medical examination of the witnesses? Therefore, we have to go into that. Then you come to the court. You see, the prosecution examination itself is sufficiently vulgar. Cross-examination is worse. So the victim goes through the traumatic experience not once, but throughout. And then, ultimately, no one shames the rapist. But someone says that the life has come to an end for the victim or the survivor. So very often she thinks it was better not to survive than to, you see, suffer all this ignominy. Now, these are all very important. Then the environment in which these offenders grow up, that's the responsibility of the civil society. Trafficking, we suggested as to be a new offence for a simple reason. If you see, we inquired and came to know, these children and women used for trafficking, they come only by rail or by bus, etc. What is the difficulty in the police personnel checking at the entry point and ensuring? I mean, after all, they can find out who are they, where they are going. Then the juvenile homes, the protection homes, the manner in which they are administered. Many administrators are responsible for exposing the inmates to all kinds of sexual crimes. Now, unless you improve that, unless you go after them, how can you stop that? So trafficking has to be a new offense, because that's the origin in most of the cases. And mind you, all these inferences are drawn only from the available statistics, which are not complete. Everyone agrees that these statistics are not the complete picture. But whatever statistics are available are sufficiently shocking. Now, you see, therefore, this had also to be gone into. Ultimately, rehabilitation homes, etc., protection homes, etc., juvenile justice homes, they are all connected issues. Because prevention is more important than the cure when it happens. Punishment, all right, but only for offences which happen in spite of due diligence and care being taken to prevent those offences as much as possible. So preventive measures have also to be gone into. Not that after the rape is committed within 4 days, you have been able to catch the rapist. Well, that's your job. I mean, what is so commendable about it that you go about, you see, saying that, well, we immediately within 4 days caught the rapist. Now, according to me, this reveals a much bigger malady that exposes the mindset that you think that alone is your job. Now, this mindset has to be corrected. Why is it that today also, the birth of a son, there is rejoicing, but then not so in a girl? And mind you, in affluent families too, this is what is happening. And the more affluent areas in Delhi and around have much worse skewed ratio, sex ratio, than the comparatively other areas. So it is the mindset which must improve. Therefore, to improve the environment, what is necessary is also the education from birth, that is at home, then the schools, and it has to be a continuing education throughout, for which the society has a large part to play. Now, coming to, I mean, I'm just giving a brief that thing because I don't know how many of you may have seen that, you may have only read the comments. Now, electoral reforms with which you would be directly concerned. Well, when you say, what are electoral reforms got to do? It's like this. If you are to make a law for gender sensitivity, and you are not gender sensitive, how are you going to deal with it? At least, I mean, it's something like this. I, being a judge, required to decide cases, unaware of the constitutional philosophy, I'm going to make a hash of it. And therefore, if you are to do a job, you must train yourself, and your mindset should be so, you see, so prepared that you are really gender sensitive. Unless you believe in that kind of equality which the Constitution guarantees, and you believe that the bodily integrity and the right to life with dignity of a woman is as sacrosanct as your own as a male, and as a matter of fact, we have in our Constitution the provision for affirmative action also, so that those who are disadvantaged have till they are treated and accepted as equals, to be given a little more advantage. So you have to deal with these issues that way. Now, electoral reforms, we have talked about why. Because if persons with criminal antecedents are to decide this issue, think for yourself whether, you see, I mean, that is the proper kind of mindset, which is something like this, that I with criminal antecedents am required to function as a judge. Now, you see, it's not difficult to imagine how I'm going to function. So when you are performing this duty, you have to remember that not only your primary status of a citizen continues, to which are attached these fundamental duties, but in addition you have a duty to perform, to discharge the role of legislator, to make laws in conformity with the Constitution, and to carry forward the constitutional promise. ये बात सही है कि कुछ चीज़ें पॉलिटिक्स के ऊपर होनी चाहिए, जैसा कि अभी आपने कहा कि इसमें पार्टी के हिसाब से फ़र्क नहीं होना चाहिए कि भाई एक आप पॉइंट स्कोर करने के लिए कि ये करें कि इनके राज में ये हो रहा है, ये एक कॉमन वो होना चाहिए. कुछ चीज़ें ऐसी होने चाहिए जो नेशनल इंटरेस्ट में हैं, बाकी कॉन्स्टिट्यूशनल फिलॉसफी को प्रमोट करने के, कॉन्स्टिट्यूशनल प्रॉमिस को रियलाइज़ करने, उनमें एक राय होनी चाहिए. और ये जो आपने अभी बताया कि भाई ये पॉइंट स्कोर करने वाली बात नहीं है कि आपके राज में ये हो रहा है उधर, सवाल यह है कि अगर कहीं कम हो रहा है तो उसको, जैसे आपने कहा, ज़रूर है, ज़रूरत है पता करने की कि भाई कम किस वजह से हो रहा है. इस वजह से हो रहा है कि जुर्म कम हो रहे हैं, कि इस वजह से कम हो रहा है कि जुर्म का रजिस्ट्रेशन नहीं हो रहा है. मैं आपको बताऊं अपना खुद का एक्सपीरियंस, मतलब सुप्रीम कोर्ट में तो जजेस और चीफ जस्टिस का कोई एडमिनिस्ट्रेशन का काम होता नहीं, बट हाई कोर्ट में होता है, क्योंकि हाई कोर्ट में सबॉर्डिनेट जुडिशरी के ऊपर. तो वहाँ भी दो हाई कोर्ट में जो चीफ जस्टिस रहा, तो वहाँ पर डिस्पोजल की फिगर जो थी, मैंने देखा किसी किसी के जब वो शुरू हुआ कि डिस्पोजल की फिगर्स जो हैं परफॉर्मेंस असेसमेंट के लिए होती हैं, मैंने देखा किसी किसी का 200% है. मैंने कहा भाई 100% तो गुड एनफ, बट ये 200 कहाँ से, तो कमाल के हैं. तो मेरे मुझको ये पता चला कि वो क्या करते हैं कि एक मुकदमे को लगा तो अदम पैरवी में खारिज कर दिया, तो एक नंबर हो गया. दूसरे दिन दरख्वास्त लगी या शाम को ही दरख्वास्त लगी रिस्टोर करने की, उसको रिस्टोर कर लिया तो दो नंबर हो गया, समझा. पुराना मुकदमा जो है वो चल रहा है 10 बरस से 20 बरस से, नया वाला छांट छांट के जो छोटा छोटा है. तो मैंने तो खैर उसको अमल करना शुरू किया, मैंने और भी जिन जजेस को भेजता था, मैंने कहा भाई जहाँ मैं जाता हूँ ये जो स्टैटिस्टिक्स है इनको तो मैं देखता भी नहीं हूँ. मैं कहता हूँ भाई अपना तरीका आपको निकालना चाहिए, कुछ रैंडम आपने वो किया. दूसरा, आपने क्या किया कि सब में पुराना मुकदमा मंगाया, देखा कहाँ है का है. अगर कोई मुकदमा 10 साल से चल रहा है वहीं का वहीं है, तो आपके 300% भी डिस्पोजल हो किस काम का, समझा. तो इस किस्म से कुछ तरीके, जैसा कि मैंने वो एग्ज़ाम्पल बताया ना कुछ ही दिन पहले, वो यूपी के गवर्नर साहब ने पूछा उस एसएसपी से, जब उन्होंने कहा कि भाई जब शिकायत दर्ज नहीं होती है तो लोग सीधे मेरे पास आ जाते हैं, तो उन्होंने कहा कि आपको ये नहीं लगता कि आपके पास क्यों आए हैं, अगर उनकी शिकायत दर्ज हो गई होती तो क्यों आते आपके पास. तो आपने क्या किया उस थानेदार का जिसने कि जिसके थाने में रिपोर्ट दर्ज नहीं हुई. तो इस किस्म के मेथड्स, और बेसिकली जो मैसेज आपने दिया हुई है, इन सब चीज़ों को आपकी राजनीति के ऊपर रखिए, क्योंकि आखिर में आप सब अपने अपने तरीके से सोच फर्क हो सकती है, लेकिन मुद्दा तो एक ही है. तो अगर वो मुद्दा एक ही है तो उसमें क्यों फ़र्क होना चाहिए, ये बातें ज़रूरी हैं.